So over the course of the next few talks, Dietrich and I are going to talk to you a little bit about the use of preclinical data to help to design clinical trials, and I'm mostly going to focus on the scientific premise. So I think over the course of the past several days and talking with a lot of people, people are using drugs for certain trials that are already used for other indications, with the basis for that being some preclinical data that they've seen that support the idea of moving forward into a clinical trial with that agent. I think there's lots of things that people need to think about when moving forward with something like that, and NIH has had a lot of efforts in this direction over the past few years. And so, as I mentioned, I'll focus on the scientific premise, with key features being reproducibility of preclinical data, the scientific rigor of the design, and also the transparency of reporting. And then Dietrich's going to speak to you about some of the non-clinical prerequisites for clinical trials, with an emphasis on some FDA requirements. So I think everybody already knows that I work for Janssen. And so over the course of this talk, I really want to spend some time talking about some of the challenges that you face when trying to translate preclinical findings into new therapies, and then to discuss a little bit the impact of reproducibility in preclinical studies, and the impact that the scientific rigor of study design and the conduct can have, and some of the features that people have noticed when reviewing the literature that really can impact these features, and also the transparency of the reporting and the impact that can have when a lot of details aren't actually presented within the primary paper. And then NIH, as well as many other efforts, are ongoing to try to address some of these concerns about preclinical as well as clinical studies and how these different features can impact the interpretation of those results. So I first just want to touch upon some of the challenges when looking at preclinical studies and how to try to move those forward into novel therapies. So I think all of us any day we can pick up the newspaper or look at different magazines and see that almost any different disorder has been cured already. And so just, you know, a very quick review on the internet of things for Alzheimer's disease, there's new treatments that fully restore memory function. These breakthroughs could be game changers. There might be a cure, and that cure might actually be at Stanford. But when looking at these papers and publications more closely, we really start to see that these are things that were done as cell-based therapies or done in mice studies, and really the direct clinical transferability of these is somewhat questionable, but if you were to only be looking at those initial headlines, you'd think that you don't need to do research anymore. And there's many, many disorders out there where there's been many mice cured of every single disease. This is just one table outlining for Parkinson's disease. There's been numerous drugs. All of these tend to have different mechanisms of action. Multiple animal models have shown that all of these drugs seem to cure the most of Parkinson's disease, but then every single one of them has failed to show a benefit. And oftentimes we're left with the question, is this a truly negative trial where the medication doesn't work, or is it a failed trial due to some limitations of the study design? So what are the possible reasons for this lack of translation from preclinical work into clinical trials? One of them is thinking about the mechanisms and the models that are used. So is the mechanism of the disease well understood? Can we really have a model that's going to recapitulate the human disorder? So we can think about something like MPTP for Parkinson's disease. That's a mitochondrial toxin, causes loss of the dopaminergic neurons. But is that really relevant to the main reason why cells die within patients with Parkinson's disease? And then also with that whole list of different mechanisms that people have evaluated, is that really the underlying mechanism for the disorder, or is it just something at a scientific level seems as though it may be contributing? And also, when looking at animal models, these are oftentimes acute toxins. And so if you inject a mouse with MPTP, its cells die, and then you have an animal model of Parkinson's disease, people thought. But when you compare that to the actual disease itself, of course, Parkinson's is slowly progressive. And also, oftentimes, with these toxins or with these different animal models, you don't have the recapitulation of the pathology that you would see clinically. So for Parkinson's disease, alpha-synuclein mouse models, it seems like that would be a really interesting route to go. However, the pathology that you see in Parkinson's disease isn't recapitulated in those animal models. So I think it's very clear that these models have their limitations. Other reasons why we may have challenges with the translation of preclinical work into clinical studies is thinking about the different properties of the drug. So does the intervention get to the target? Does it actually cross the blood-brain barrier? And when people look, you know, back across a multitude of trials, this wasn't always evaluated, and it is possible in many of them that the drug never got to the target. And if it does get to the target, does it actually engage the target? And is it at the target at a sufficient concentration to actually mediate an effect? And if it's at the target, does it still be present in a form that's active, or something happened to it along the route that now it's an inactive form? And also, and this is a key question that we certainly talked about in probably all the small groups, is this the dosage that you've chosen to evaluate? Is that a sufficient dose to mediate an effect? And Dietrich later will talk about some of the potential toxicities of drugs and how that may impact the lack of translation and also the maximum tolerated dose. So another reason which I think is critically important to think about is the lack of reproducibility of published data and how that may impact this translation from preclinical to clinical. So we'll talk a little more about the importance of the preclinical study design and the impact that that may have. And also, when looking at publications, oftentimes the details that would be needed to actually reproduce the study aren't contained within the publication. So there's no way to be able to reproduce it, or if people try, they don't have the details that would enable them to do so. So I think a question that came up at NINDS a few years ago, and it was Shai Silverberg in one of the groups, really sort of focused on the idea of should clinicians really care about preclinical animal research. And just highlighting a few of the statements made within the outset of this article is clinicians really need to be able to trust that the rationale for moving forward into the clinical trial is sound, a sound rationale. And many articles have underscored the fact that many preclinical studies don't provide key information on the design, conduct, and the data analysis. And so he proposes two questions. How feasible is it for reviewers, journal editors, or readers to identify methodologic flaws when the details aren't even presented? And how can the neurologic community critically evaluate claims made in studies when the key methodological parameters aren't included? So I think this raises the question of when you're reading papers and looking at something that's preclinical, are there sufficient data presented to you to really feel that this is something that you want to spend your time moving forward? So a little bit more about reproducibility in preclinical studies. So I think this is a rather interesting article. It's from 2012, and it was a study done by Amgen where they looked at what was considered 53 landmark papers, and they then went and tried to reproduce the studies to achieve, you know, confirmation of the results that were found, and they were only able to reproduce 11% of the findings. And so, you know, you wouldn't expect that you'd be able to repeat 100%, but the fact that only 11% seemed to be something that was reproducible, I think, certainly is a significant concern. And so, again, what types of things in terms of preclinical studies can be contributing to this lack of reproducibility? And leadership at NINDS, or I'm sorry, at NIH, including Francis Collins, proposed a series of features that may be contributing to this in a paper that was published in Nature in 2014. And they identified many factors that they think are important. One is that there's insufficient training of researchers in experimental design for preclinical studies. And also, when trying to publish your preclinical data, there's a real emphasis on trying to have a really cool idea, make provocative statements about it, perhaps not include all the technical details that would be important. And also to try to get it a lot of attention and to have it seem a very interesting finding, there oftentimes can be overinterpretation of some creative hypothesis-generating studies. So these things were hypothesis-generated, but somehow now have become conclusions that perhaps are overstated. And also, as we've already mentioned, within publications, the key elements of how to do the study actually aren't included. And so they went on to mention some critical considerations for preclinical work to think about. One is that there is a lack of publication of negative data. This certainly also happens with in clinical work as well, but just recognizing you may see a positive study out there, but there also might be 10 failed studies that just aren't something that you're able to see. Also, the publications tend not to ever retrospectively go back and talk about the limitations of the studies, or to always indicate the scientific flaws of published results. And of course, if the data aren't published, you can't know about them, you can't really assess them. So NIH back in 2014 published a paper about their plans to enhance reproducibility to try to address some of these concerns. And they identified five critical elements for the design of preclinical studies. These are things that we've certainly talked about in this course and are probably from a clinical standpoint things that seem very apparent, but when looking back at the preclinical data, the majority of studies often didn't address these, so issues of blinding. of randomization between treatment groups, replication of study results. Often there just would be the one paper that shows the finding and nobody would reproduce it. And as we've seen, oftentimes these things can't be reproduced. Sample size as well, you know, we've got six mice, might as well kind of put those into groups and move on without ever really having sample size calculation. And also not taking into consideration potential effects of sex differences. So this is an interesting paper from JAMA from 2006, and it's addressing from seven different journals, looking at over 500 citations from 1980 to 2000, looking at some of these features and how often they were done within different preclinical studies. So here you can see less than 20% had randomization, less than 20% adjusted for multiplicity, or had blinding. So I think you can see that there really are some concerns about the way preclinical work has been done, and that there's an ongoing effort to try to improve this. So now I just want to talk about some of the efforts that have been ongoing, and certainly NIH has taken the lead in some of the efforts to try to make this increase awareness around these issues, and also to try to implement ways that will encourage or require people to include these in their studies. So in 2012, there was a paper published from senior leaders at NIH really calling for a reporting of transparency to try to improve the ability for people to replicate studies. And subsequent to this, many journals have included a checklist, just like with clinical trials, and a checklist for preclinical studies to make sure that certain features have been done in terms of the conduct of the study. And these include things, as we've spoken about, sample size justifications, and including details about how many, or details about the methods and details about the different reagents used to really allow someone to go back and repeat the study. And also they want to know within these checklists how many times the experiment was able to be repeated. So if it was just done once, that potentially is now something which people will be aware of. So as I mentioned, NIH really is taking this as a real important issue to try to increase the quality of research. There's a website here, and if you were to go to this, there would be a million links that you can go to learn all about what NIH thinks on this matter. But there have been several notices that I just want to call to your attention to make people a little bit more aware. And this really applies to preclinical work, clinical work, and also to the review process. So in 2015, there was an overall effort to really guide people in terms of what they include within their application and also in terms of review. This was all focused on trying to enhance reproducibility by increasing the rigor of the studies and also, as I mentioned, increasing the transparency of reporting. And this went into effect over a year ago. And there were four main areas that are being focused on for these efforts. One of them is the scientific premise. So those of you who are taking agents which are approved for another indication, you've seen some interesting preclinical data, and now you want to use that to support your idea to move forward into a clinical trial. There are certain things that I think you want to pause and think about a little bit. One is the scientific premise. So looking back at those publications that are suggesting that this agent may be effective, think about the strengths and weaknesses of those data and also the preliminary data that you have that support moving forward. Also, looking at the experimental design of those preclinical studies, were they done in a way that are going to give you unbiased results and a robust result? Have they done those different things in terms of blinding, sample size calculations? And also in terms of looking at different biological variables, taking those into account within the design, the analysis of the study. And then also making sure that details about how the study was done and what reagents are used are looked at. And that's probably more of an application for the preclinical work. But as you're reviewing things, you want to make sure that those types of details are indeed included within the preclinical work so you know that people have thought about these types of criteria. So within NINDS itself, there was a lot of effort put into trying to improve clinical research based on these preclinical findings. So again, there was a real effort to try and make sure the experimental design of the preclinical work was strong. Was there a good rationale for the endpoint? Was there sample size justification, appropriate controls, and appropriate statistical methods? This is within the preclinical work that you're going to reference within your clinical application. Also, again, making sure that studies were conducted in a way that minimizes bias, and to make sure that it wasn't just one paper that supports this idea, but that there's been replication, and also an indication that there was target engagement, that the drug that you want to study really gets to where it needs to, mediate the effect that you're hoping that you'll see. And also in looking at papers and looking at those results, to really think through, are there alternative explanations or alternative ways to think about these data, or is this really a strong conclusion that you want to base your next study on? So these types of requirements have been integrated into the clinical trial funding announcements from NINDS as well as other institutes. And really, you want to make sure that the data that you're going to include for your rationale are able to meet the guidelines that NIH has published within the notices that I mentioned and will be referenced on that website. And again, you want to make sure that your preclinical data have the scientific rigor that you want to see before moving forward, that they use strategies to minimize bias, that the results are reproducible, and also that you thought about different ways to interpret the data before you bank the next several years of your life working on a trial. You want to make sure that premise is really strong. So there is, and this will be able to be referenced from that original link that I showed you, but also if you just Google rigor and reproducibility in NIH and go to your table or chart, you'll come up with this. This really helps to outline for you the different, areas of focus, including the scientific premise, rigor, the biological variables, and then reproducibility and authentication, and where within your application you should include those. So I hope in terms of the question that I presented to you earlier, as a clinician, should you care about preclinical animal research? Hopefully you now agree with me that yes, you need to, if not only for the ability to hopefully be funded, but also really to feel comfortable that your rationale for moving forward has a strong basis. So overall, I think it's important to think very carefully about the preclinical data that you're analyzing before moving forward with your study. You want to make sure that it has the scientific rigor, that there's transparency in reporting so that that's something that someone could have reproduced. And also, when thinking about your study, is the study designed appropriately? Was the preclinical work designed appropriately? Have efforts been maintained to minimize bias? Do you have replication of the results from the literature? And have you considered alternate ways to interpret your data to make sure that it is reasonable to try to move forward with that translation from preclinical to clinical? And now I'll turn over to Dietrich.
So my name is Dietrich.